I'm Megan Keith. Welcome to the History of Music, an introduction to the Western classical music tradition. In part two, the Middle Ages and the Renaissance, we will learn how music survived and evolved after the collapse of the Roman Empire. Although the church disapproved of any music other than sacred plain chant, music continued to develop through new melodies and instrumentation. Perhaps the most important development of the early Middle Ages was polyphony, which is the combination of two or more simultaneous melodies. However, not all music of this time was sacred. Secular music was starting to develop through courtly love songs. Some noblemen, known as troubadours, began setting their own poems to music and would travel singing and sharing their pieces. Today's program also highlights the many musical instruments created during the Middle Ages, including an early version of the bagpipes, a plucked instrument called a psaltery, and a predecessor to the modern guitar, the lute. The 14th and 15th centuries marked a turning point in musical development. A new philosophy called humanism led to a new wave of experimentation in secular music, as people began focusing on life on earth rather than just life in the afterworld. Composers like John Dunstable, Guillaume Dufay, Johannes Ockeghem, and Josquin des Prez brought music to new heights, greatly influencing music's role in the early Renaissance period. During the 1500s, different countries began showcasing different musical flavors. The French began experimenting with counterpoint in their chansons. The madrigal became a trend in England and Italy, and the Germans created their own distinct style of polyphony. The religious upheavals of the early 16th century also influenced sacred music, as new denominations had their own ideas of how music should be played and used. While instruments were previously only used to accompany vocal music, individual instrumental styles finally started to take shape. Composers began combining the sounds of different groups of instruments, paving the way for the modern orchestration we are familiar with today.
Around 100 AD, early Christians began practicing a form of chanting adapted largely from their Jewish heritage. Called plain chant, it was pure unaccompanied melody. Because the church disapproved of any other forms of music, plain chant was the only music handed down from that period to future generations. While we know how church music developed, little information was preserved about music outside the church until about the 10th century. The church believed that music should make the listener or participant receptive to holy thoughts and feelings. Since words were considered necessary for this purpose, purely instrumental music was prohibited. Most musical practices other than plain chant were associated with non-Christian traditions, and the church wanted to shield its followers from reminders of rival faiths. So, plain chant became a symbol, a means of ensuring intellectual, spiritual, and aesthetic solidarity within the Christian domain. At first, no precise notation was used for plain chant. Symbols called neumes, shown between the lines of this manuscript, indicated only the rise and fall in pitch and the division of syllables. Around the year 600, Pope Gregory the Great attempted to organize the various chants that had spread through Christendom. His compilation has become known as Gregorian Chant. These bare, unadorned melodies have remained vital to Catholic worship into the 21st century. Modern composers often return to them when they want to evoke a solemn, sacred atmosphere.
Around 850, singers began improvising melodies parallel to the chant melodies. The intervals between these parallel melodies emphasized fourths and fifths, which tend to sound stark and hollow to modern ears, but were regarded at the time as the purest, most natural sounds.
These parallel melodies were a step toward polyphony, the combining of two or more musical lines. Gradually, polyphony became more complex, as parallel melodies were replaced by musical lines that moved independently. Polyphony is one of the most distinctive characteristics of Western music.
Early polyphonic music was still based largely on plain chant melodies. In this piece from the 12th century, the chant is sung and played on instruments in long, sustained notes, while three faster, rhythmically regular melodies are sung above it. Used this way, the chant melody is called a cantus firmus. By the year 1200, Paris was one of the great centers of musical development, the source of a new type of vocal music called the motet, in which rhythm was specified for the first time. Rhythms were selected from several specific patterns, similar to poetic meters. Not all early motets were sacred. In some, each melodic line was given a different text. One piece might include a Latin religious poem, an earthy French love song, and a satirical political commentary. As early as the 10th century, when information about secular music began to be preserved, jugglers and traveling minstrels, called jongleurs, danced, played, and sang their own songs in the courts and on the streets. In taverns, wandering university students entertained themselves and others with drinking songs and love songs. Some songs dealt with both subjects, and their lyrics sometimes combined both Latin and the local language. Between 1100 and 1300, some French noblemen started a trend, writing poems about courtly love and setting them to music. These troubadours, as they were called, traveled throughout the country singing and playing their pieces. By the 14th century, troubadours were also popular in German-speaking countries, where they were called minnesingers, or singers of love songs. Here, minnesingers are depicted at school, learning rules of composition and performance. Before long, troubadours were traveling in many parts of Europe. An English piece, Summer is a Coomin' In, is perhaps the best-known work from the time. It is believed to be the oldest surviving example of a round, and an important early instance of full six-voice polyphony.
Instruments of the Middle Ages included drums and a predecessor of the bagpipe, often used by peasants to accompany dances. The organ was widely used in church services. Brass and wind instruments were played during ceremonies at court. Artists of the time often portrayed music as a gift from heaven. The angels in this painting are performing on the principal instruments of the day. This is a psaltery, mentioned in the Bible, which is a plucked instrument similar to a modern zither. On the right is a lute, a relative of the guitar. Two lutes are being played in this piece. On the left is the one-stringed tromba marina, which has no modern counterpart. A medieval trumpet of either brass or wood is on the left, and on the right, a shawm, a double reed instrument. Its ancestor was the Greek allos, its modern descendant, the oboe. This medieval dance is played by four shawms, accompanied by a drum. The angel on the left is playing a buissine, an ancestor of our trombone. Without a slide, it could play only a few notes. The other angel has a trumpet. This humorous piece is performed by two shawms, two buissines, and a trumpet. This angel is operating the bellows of a portable organ with the left hand, while the right fingers one or two notes at a time. The harp remained much like the Egyptian harp of 2,000 years earlier. Next to it is the fiddle, the small bowed instrument that eventually developed into the viol and, later on, into the violin.
The 14th century was an experimental period when secular music overtook sacred music in importance. Rhythmic patterns expanded dramatically, giving rise to freer, more complex compositions. The most significant composer of this time was Guillaume de Machaut, who excelled in both sacred and secular styles and possessed literary and political talents as well. In Italy, the blind composer Francesco Landini adapted the new techniques in his own way, placing less emphasis on complexity than his French colleagues did. Landini concentrated on simpler rhythms and more direct melodies in a new type of secular song, the madrigal. In England, John Dunstable emphasized harmony based on thirds and sixths, intervals that sounded very different from the fourths and fifths commonly used before. Dunstable's intervals lent a smooth, rich quality that soon attracted other composers. As the 14th century was drawing to a close, musicians were becoming interested more in the sensuous aspects of their art than in the technical aspects of structure. This change was especially evident among those composers who acknowledged Dunstable's influence. The powerful Duchy of Burgundy, made up of Belgium, the Netherlands, and Eastern France, was the most fertile cultural center in Europe during the first half of the 15th century. Attracting artists and musicians from all over the continent, its styles became internationally accepted. The leading Burgundian composers were Guillaume Dufay and Gilles Benchois, two learned men who developed Dunstable's new sounds into a distinctive musical style.
A fundamental aspect of Western music, and of most music around the world, is tonality, the tendency of a musical composition to gravitate to one particular note, called the tonic. When a piece of music arrives at the tonic, the listener feels a sense of resolution or completion. The approach to tonality has varied throughout the centuries, sometimes favoring a strong pull to the tonic, and other times favoring a weak one. If the pull is strong, the music sounds direct and decisive. If the pull is weak, the music tends to sound uncertain, as if reaching for something unattainable.
During the Middle Ages, music reflected a moderate sense of tonality, gentle rather than emphatic. However, the new approach to harmony developing in Burgundy gave rise to a slightly stronger tonal pull, setting a trend that would govern musical development for centuries. In addition, the music introduced by Dufay and his like-minded contemporaries had an unprecedented richness and translucence. Late in the 15th century, the focus was on choral music, polyphonic works written for several singers per voice part instead of for solo voices. And Flanders, an area within the Duchy of Burgundy, became the center of musical activity. With Johannes Ockeghem, a powerfully influential composer and teacher of the time as its pioneer, the new Flemish style spread quickly. Renaissance composers throughout Europe strove for a new ideal in sound. The ideal was represented by a chorus divided into four equally important voice parts: soprano, alto, tenor, and bass, with little or no instrumental accompaniment. The voice parts wove among one another, with no one voice predominating. Rhythm was fluid and free, tonality distinct. The expressive effect had an immediate impact on listeners. The music was smooth, homogeneous, spiritual rather than personal, creating a mystical or otherworldly effect appropriate for sacred themes. The Latin Mass, an ideal vehicle for the Flemish style, soon became the chief musical form. Composers wrote hundreds of different settings of the Mass, often building them around a particular plain chant melody, the Cantus Firmus, as a means of creating unity.
While Flemish composers were refining their style, a cultural revolution was taking place in Italy. A whole new philosophy called humanism, a concern with the quality of life on earth, was developing hand in hand with unprecedented prosperity. The church lost its monopoly over the arts as more private individuals began supporting artists and musicians, even posing for sculptures and paintings. All the arts were stimulated by this explosion in ideas as well as opportunities. But Italians had not reached the same level of sophistication in music as in the other arts, so the most brilliant Flemish musicians and composers were imported to serve and to teach in the Italian courts. The development of printing, and then of movable type, simplified music publication. Without each note having to be hand-copied, music could be sold and performed more widely than ever before. How-to manuals for amateur musicians were published, along with more traditional scholarly texts. Music now enjoyed greater prestige than ever before, and contemporary music was the most popular of all.
The Flemish composer Josquin des Prez was considered the greatest composer of all. Regarded even today among the supreme masters, he served in the Italian and French courts as well as in the papal chapel. Josquin's music was published widely and known throughout Europe. Although he wrote masses in the Flemish style, he focused on the motet, which by the year 1500 had changed since Mochaut used the form more than a century earlier. Shorter and more flexible than the Mass, the motet allowed the composer greater opportunity to invent and experiment. Josquin des Prez was a master of imitative counterpoint, a characteristic feature of Renaissance polyphony. In imitative counterpoint, various musical lines enter one after the other, each starting with the same pattern of notes so that the later entrances appear to be imitating the first. Because Josquin's music was less ornate than that of his predecessors, it more effectively reflected the images and feelings suggested by the words. Its simplicity also underlined its sense of tonal clarity. Josquin's polyphony suggests a spiritual conversation among equal participants. Although the voices seem to move independently, they are delicately balanced to maintain fluid continuity until the music settles into a cadence or temporary resting point. During the same time, styles in secular music were becoming more distinctly national. These national differences became pronounced by the early 1500s. French chanson, the word for songs, often combined imitative counterpoint with texts ranging from serious to bawdy. The melodies of some popular chansons were used as cantus firmi in sacred compositions. In Italy, most secular music had simpler polyphony, clearer rhythms, and more direct melodies. Landini's madrigals of two centuries earlier were forgotten, but the form had evolved into sophisticated polyphonic songs for small vocal groups based on extravagantly romantic poetry, sometimes with erotic double meanings. Madrigals were great fun for singers and were much appreciated by the aristocrats they entertained. Composers, turning them out by the thousands, often experimented with the form. Claudio Monteverdi, a leading Italian composer who excelled at the madrigal, built on its close relationship between music and text, and its often speech-like character, to become a pioneer in opera. The English madrigal, another offshoot from the Italian original, acquired its own style, generally lighter in mood and texture. German music of the time developed more slowly, but as musical trends spread from France and Italy, unique polyphonic song styles emerged in Germany, as well as in Spain and Eastern Europe.
During the first half of the 15th century, music was profoundly affected by the Protestant and Catholic reformations, the religious upheavals that gave rise to many small denominations. One Protestant, Martin Luther, was a musician himself. Though he rejected papal authority, he retained elements of the Latin liturgy in his own services, gradually shaping a hymn style that remained central to German religious music for centuries. One of Luther's most famous chorales is still widely sung, "Eine feste Burg ist unser Gott," a mighty fortress is our God. John Calvin, another Protestant, eliminated all music from worship, except for the unaccompanied singing of biblical texts. Huldreich Zwingli, who saw corruption in all the arts, destroyed a church organ with his own hands to demonstrate his conviction that music should be banned from the church, along with holy statues and pictures. The Puritans from England and the Moravians from east of Germany, among the first settlers of the American colonies, were members of religious reform groups who brought to the New World their strict attitudes toward music and art. Music also became an issue as part of the reform movement within the Catholic Church. Among the practices frowned upon were the use of secular cantus firmi in sacred works and complex polyphony, which was thought to draw too much attention to the music while obscuring the words.
The Italian Giovanni Pierluigi da Palestrina was the most successful of the European composers who tried to accommodate their art to the more restrained standards of the church. Palestrina was a master of Flemish polyphonic technique, with a modest introspective style close in spirit to an earlier time, to the devout serenity of plain chant. In his more than 100 masses and 400 motets, he compensated for the lack of bold harmonic effects by emphasizing a variety of different sonorities. As religious choral music was reaching its peak around 1550, instrumental styles were just beginning to take shape. Until that time, vocal and instrumental music sounded alike. Instruments were used to accompany dancing, with much of the music improvised. As composers began to write instrumental music just for listening, they often borrowed popular dance styles. The instrumental canzona, the Italian word for song, grew out of the vocal form, but soon developed into a style mainly for brass instruments, light, fast, and rhythmic. Instrumental music was generally played by groups of the same instrument family, string, brass, or recorder ensembles, with instruments ranging from low to high. However, mixed groups of instruments occasionally played together, paving the way for modern orchestration. Music was also composed for the keyboard instruments, harpsichord, clavichord, and organ. Repetition and contrast were used to create interesting instrumental pieces. Composers began to make larger works by creating variations on a popular tune and by stringing together series of dances in contrasting tempos. The most popular household instrument was the lute, used alone as well as to accompany singing. Toward the end of the 16th century, Venice, a cosmopolitan city where various cultures met and crossed, was the center of musical experiments with large groups of instruments and voices. The strong contrasts and vigorous expression that characterized this music forecasted a new era in the arts, a style that came to be known as Baroque.